Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the 26th meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2022. The first item on the agenda is consideration of whether to take items 6, 7 and 8 in private. Item 6 is the consideration of evidence that we will hear on the legislative consent memorandum. Item 7 is the consideration of the committee's work programme, and item 8 is the consideration of candidates for the post of advisor on climate change. Are we all agreed to take these items in private?
Agreed.
We are agreed. Good. So the second item on the agenda is an evidence session relating to the legislative consent memorandum on the UK Levelling Up and Regeneration Bill. And I refer members to the Clark and Spice briefing papers on this item. The bill was introduced into the UK Parliament on the 11th of May 2022. On the 27th of July, the Scottish Government lodged a legislative consent memorandum on the bill. It said that the bill touches on devolved legislative or executive competence in three areas, including environmental law through the proposed introduction of environmental outcome reports. These will be the focus of our scrutiny, and today we're going to hear from a panel of witnesses to hear their views. And I'd like to welcome the three panellists: Lloyd Austin, the convener of the Scottish Environment Link Governance Group; Robbie Calvert, the Policy Practice and Research Officer at the Royal Town Planning Institute; and David Malhuish, the Director of the Scottish Property Federation. I'd like to thank you all for accepting our invitations, and we're delighted to have you here. We've got about 60 minutes for this evidence session, and before I move to the first person who's going to ask questions, I'd just like to remind members that I am a qualified surveyor and have a planning interest behind me when I was in private practice. So the first questions are going to be from Monica Lennon. Monica.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. Just want to begin by asking each of you to briefly state what your general views are on the Levelling Up and Regeneration Bill, and I'll just start with Lloyd and work across the table.
Yeah, thank you. I think I'd say three things about not the bill as a whole, but part five, the environmental outcomes report section, which is what we're speaking to. But I'd say three things about that particular part of the bill. The first one, which is going to be limited, is a positive, and that's the word outcome, because I do think that in environmental law and environmental policy generally, it's good to have outcomes. Having said that that's a positive, it's very unclear as to what the outcomes are going to be and how they're going to be determined. I think the second thing I'd say as an overview is that the provisions in general are very vague. There are lots of provisions to allow the Secretary of State to make regulations about this, that and the other without indicating how they're going to be done, what they're for, how they interact with existing regulations, whether they supersede or replace existing regulations, etc., etc. So there's an awful lot of what's commonly known as Henry VIII powers, in other words, kind of vagueness and lack of clarity in regard to what's intended and how it's going to be done and who's going to be involved, etc., etc. And in that regard, environmental NGOs would put this in the list of issues of concern about the UK government's approach to environment, notwithstanding the fact that there is a kind of high-level rhetorical commitment to environment. When you actually look at some of the detail, it's unclear what's going to happen. And in the context of other measures like the retained EU law bill, for instance.
I'm going to interrupt you because I probably haven't had enough coffee this morning. When I asked the question, I meant to say, you know, your views in the context of how it interacts with devolved policy. So just to give the rest of the panel the heads up. So if I can maybe drill down into that briefly.
Well, that was going to be my third point.
I thought you were getting there.
my third point relates to devolution. And it has to be said that a lot of the bill is for England only. Mm-hmm. There is reference to some reserved matters, which obviously apply UK-wide and apply to Scotland, and Part 5 does extend to Scotland. I mean, it needs to because of those reserved matters. But it's actually a bit unclear when it comes to devolution, insofar as it specifically allows environmental outcome reports for devolved areas. In fact, clause 121 says that they may make regulations in relation to devolved environmental law subject to consultation with Scottish ministers. But the specific references to environmental assessment regulations, etc., don't list the devolved ones. So there's a lack of clarity there as to what they mean, whether it should apply to devolved or shouldn't apply to devolved. And finally, our final point on this is that, you know, if environmental law is devolved, then we think it should, these secondary provisions that might be set up by this should be subject to the consent of Scottish ministers and the Scottish Parliament in the same way that primary legislation is. This debate, your consideration of this mm-hmm. legislative consent memorandum today is an example of you scrutinising this particular piece of primary legislation. So shouldn't the same provisions apply to regulations under this if they apply to devolved laws? So we would argue that clause 121 should be amended to require consent of Scottish Parliament.
Thank you. I see Robbie from RTP Scotland nodding part of the way through that, so keen to hear what you think, Robbie.
I'm completely in agreement with Lloyd regarding section 121, and we also support amendments to that which were tabled at some of the bill readings, so that's 178, 179 and 180. So that's sort of necessitating consent from the devolved nations. And yeah, I think even if there is changes solely to English law, I think we still need to consider that there is cross-boundary SACs and SPAs. So for example, the River Tweed, the Solway Firth in the Berwickshire and Northumberland coast. So going forward, we want to see how these kind of cross-boundary issues are going to be taken into consideration if you do have deviating systems of environmental law. In the first instance, yes, there's a lot of confusion at the moment. There's a lot of unknowns. We are expecting a consultation on EORs. So I hope this is the beginning of an ongoing dialogue that we have. And I imagine when that's published, we'll be called for evidence again. In the first instance, we would like to see the need to change EIA, SEA processes evidenced. And we'd look to see that in a consultation as well. I know there's a lot of intention to streamline processes, and we also support kind of move to more outcomes-focused processes, but this could lead to a lot of uncertainty and complexity and actually create delays and significant resource and impacts on consenting bodies as well.
Thank you. And David, bearing in mind looking to hear about impacts on devolved policy, what's your view?
In many ways, I think the initial view is one of a lot of uncertainty among members as they've discussed it, the bill with us. This particular Part 5 section, subject of today's meeting, has been the key one that's been raised. EIAs are obviously a fundamental part of the development process, understood over a number of years. Yes, we understood that... Whatever the views you may have, the exit from the EU would mean that there would be some replacement framework. As an iterative process, that had to be addressed at some stage. But the what we have now, I think at the moment, is there's not really enough detail on the EORs to really know what they mean. I mean, in principle, I think Lloyd touched on this, the idea of focusing on outcomes as a policy principle is enticing, but I think we really need to see what it actually means in practice in terms of the actual detailed legislative proposals before commenting further. And we're obviously clearly focusing on Scotland. The rest of the regime is very much looking at competent authorities, which one way or the other find the direction, legal framework, etc., from this Parliament. And so, you know, there's probably concern at some potential duplication or confusion, if you like, between the regulatory regimes at this stage. So I think that's the initial view. And probably, unfortunately, in our submission later this month, there may very well be more questions than actual answers for the committee's interest. But I think that's where we find ourselves in this process at this stage.
Okay, so I'm hearing there's still a lot of uncertainty. If I just go back across the table then, just to get maybe a yes or no answer, if possible. But in your view, do the powers for the Secretary of State proposed in Part 5 of the bill respect the devolution settlement? Back to David.
I mean, potentially they may not, as far as you can go at the moment. I mean, if we've heard that, you know, powers that can potentially overwrite previous stances in the Parliament, then you can only really conclude that there's the potential for some conflict in the regulatory regime between the UK and between this Parliament. We hope that would not be the case. We think that's an important matter where we'd very much like to have seen, if you like, more of an understanding between the administrations of the UK before we got to this place.
Thank you. Robbie?
Yeah, as we said, we support extra safeguarding in arrangements of consenting between the nations, and that's those amendments 178, 179 and 180 to clause 121. I think one more question we have is about environmental common frameworks, which I know the committee consulted on in June. For example, one on air quality that we responded to. I don't know how they would interface with these proposals here. So that's a big question mark we have.
Okay, and Lloyd, I think we've already got a written submission from Scottish Environment Link identifying specific concerns with the bill surrounding the Sewell Convention and the possibility of the UK Parliament altering Scottish environmental laws. Do you want to expand on that?
I'd just reiterate that. I think I agree with David that potentially this bill, as it's drafted at the moment, doesn't respect the current devolution settlement in terms of seeking the consent of this Parliament in relation to legislation in devolved areas.
Thank you. I think the Deputy Convener might have questions in this area.
But we're going to go to Jackie next with her questions. We'll come to the Deputy Convener later.
Great. Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. Can I ask what your view is on the current system of environmental assessment in the UK? And do you think there is a need to simplify the current system following the EU exit? I think I'll start at the other side this time and work my way across, if you don't mind, David.
Of course. Look, this is a hugely complicated technical area. I mean, modern development, major development, sorry, in particular, is very, very complicated. I mean, talking to members in the process of looking at returning evidence to the committee, the cost of EIs themselves, most developments, you're between 80,000 and 120,000 per development, and that's in many ways that's just the start because of the complexity of the framework. So again, looking at simplification, which we do understand is behind some of the intentions of the levelling up part, is enticing. However, I think our suspicion is that regulation does tend to get more complex and demanding, and to a degree, you know, better the devil you know, which we do know at this stage in the system in Scotland, other regimes, probably colleagues elsewhere in the organisation would have to speak to. I'm afraid I think Robbie would have a good view on that, but certainly, you know, in Scotland. And I think a message I'd like to underline to the committee is you're talking potentially hundreds of major planning applications determined per year, most of which will require EIAs and related assessments. I mean, this is, you know, this is, if you like, a mini industry that's tens of millions per year, so it cannot really be underestimated in terms of the impact of changes in policy that you're considering.
Okay, thank you. Bobby?
Yeah, I mean, I think we're always welcome improving existing processes. I think in the first instance, providing the correct resource to consenting bodies. So I'm sure the committee are well rehearsed with some of our stats on the matter, but 42% cuts to planning departments since 2009, and a third reduction in staff. So in the first instance, I think resourcing consenting bodies effectively would certainly improve processes. We also think there's clear opportunities with digitisation as well and digital EIAs. So hopefully committee's got sight of our written evidence, but I've referenced a report there on, from IEMA, I think 2020, and that suggested a number of potential improvements to existing processes and opportunities therein within Scottish Government's digital planning strategy as well. So that's things like developing sort of shared cloud-based data resources around planning and place data, and establishing this foundation of data that's robust and trusted. And I think there is good examples of that already happening. For example, Crown Estate's offshore wind evidence and change programme. So yeah, I think there's a number of existing improvements we could do to current processes. I think it's good to consider you know, how many projects EIAs do actually apply to. So IEMA have done some work on this in England, but I think it was 99.9% of projects did not need an EIA. So it is, you know, larger, more significant projects. The kind of timeframes, though, that a lot of these larger, more significant kind of infrastructure projects do work to is a concern, because if changes were to come down the line in 2023, 2024, that's actually quite a short time frame for large infrastructure projects, and change could cause uncertainty and potentially delay as well.
So simplifying is not always the best then?
No, it's not.
Okay. Lloyd, you get the time.
Yeah, first of all, I reiterate Robbie's point about the number of applications that do require an EIA rather than don't need it at all. The threshold to need an EIA is a potential significant effect on the environment. So, you know, if you're going to reduce the number of applications that are going to be assessed, then you are in effect taking decisions about things that could have a significant impact on the environment without considering them. That doesn't mean that we're sort of in principle opposed to improved implementation or simplification. The one thing I would say is that when these issues are looked at, it's often the case that it's not the original law or the original process that's an issue. It's a question of streamlining the implementation, the administration, the processes. Robbie was talking about digitisation. Those are things that can make the system work better for everybody. And you know, in general, I would take the view that, you know, that the EIA system is very well known by all parties, by government, by the agencies, by developers, by communities and NGOs. And if there was going to be significant change, I would expect those proposing that significant change to provide some evidence as to what's wrong with the existing system, and I've not seen that evidence, and it's not been put forward in the explanatory notes of this bill or anything like that. So my view is that that there isn't in principle an objection to the idea of doing things in a better way. But in order to get to a better way, you need the arguments to be well evidenced and a clear proposal of what you're going to do instead, which this isn't.
My next question, convener, was going to be about if the current regime was actually working, and I think the panel's already answered that for me, so I'm not going to go and ask you again. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Jackie, and thanks for doing that. Mark, you've got some questions.
Yeah, thanks. I think you've touched on some areas already, but I guess I wanted to get a bit more information from you about the Part 5 of the bill, and particularly those clauses that really set out how this new system will work. You've covered some aspects of that already, but can I just sort of go around and get some views on the specifics of what's currently laid out as we know it and how it will actually work. Lloyd, do you want to?
Well, I think one of the challenges is that it's all about making provision for the Secretary of State to make regulations, and then we haven't seen even a draft of those regulations or a policy explanation of how they're going to work, so it's very difficult to determine. But I'll draw attention to one thing. The explanatory notes and the UK government in the debates in Westminster on the bill so far have often referred to clause 120 subsection 1, which is the issue where they call it a non-regression clause that says that the environmental protection should not be less than provided by the environmental law at the time this act is passed. My view is that that's actually a rather poor non-regression clause in as far as it's a rhetorical statement of good intent, but I don't think it has very much meat to it, if I put it that way. It's phrased that the Secretary of State may make EOR regulations only if satisfied that making the regulations will not result in environmental law providing an overall level of environmental protection that is less than provided by environmental law at the time the Act is passed. So the test is the Secretary of State's satisfaction, which is, you know, if the Secretary of State is satisfied and says he is, or she says she is, that is, in my view, if you're going to have a non-regression clause that is meaningful, then there has to be an objective measure of that non-regression, or it has to be based on the view of independent advice from the environmental agencies or Natural England, Nature Scot, CEPA, Environment Agency, or Climate Change Committee, someone of that type who can provide objective advice rather than simply the Secretary of State's satisfaction. Because, you know, if the Secretary of State is making regulations, it's almost inevitable that he or she will say they're satisfied.
Does that relate to international obligations? I mean, are they baked into this provision, or again, is that part of being satisfied? Or not?
International obligations is the next clause. It says they may not contain provision that is inconsistent with the implementation of international obligations of the United Kingdom relating to the assessment of environmental impact. So in relation to one specific set of international obligations, that is referenced, but it doesn't relate to wider environmental international obligations. So, for instance, the Aarhus Convention wouldn't necessarily fit under that definition of an obligation. So I think they could both be broadened and made more objective in terms of the their impact.
Can I just ask you, are there any other points you want to raise in relation to the detail? Now, I know, you know, you mentioned earlier that there's a sense of vagueness with it. But
yeah. I'll stick to that.
Okay, Robin?
Yeah, just to extend on discussions there about sort of international obligations. So it was confirmed at one of the bill committee hearings on the 8th of September that the UK government would still meet its obligations under the Aarhus and Espoo conventions. That's something we would support, and we'd encourage the committee to continually press for this approach. There's not a lot of detail that we have. We do understand that the proposed reforms will affect 18 different consenting regimes, one being planning, of course, which in itself interacts with other consenting regimes and their respective EIAs. As set out in the legislative consent memorandum from the Scottish Government, there's still a lot of detail we need. So, for example, the proposed contents of EORs, how they're to be taken into consideration by public authorities in decision-making and what extent they're to be considered, what plans and consents are to be subject to procedures, and actually, well, unclear about the environmental common frameworks, as I pointed out earlier, but also whether different countries could in fact have different outcomes. And that's why we've asked for proposals to be mapped out across other proposals that are going on, not least planning reform, but for example, different approaches to biodiversity net gain that have been taken in England and Scotland. How would that be taken into consideration when we think of biodiversity enhancement as a potential outcome of EORs? Something that we really need to consider thoroughly. So I'll leave it there for now.
Is there clarity over plans and programmes, whether they may or may not be captured by this? Or...
Yeah. So we don't have that at this stage. I expect that to come out with the consultation. Okay. Of course.
David?
I think I said earlier, the problem is that there isn't the detail there for us to get to grips with underneath the top level principles. And certainly our understanding and assumption had been that the intention was to not go backwards in terms of standards and the level of regulation. But I must admit, having listened to Lloyd, I think I'll re-ask our members the same question on that as to how satisfied they are at that level. But again, it just underlines the uncertainty we've got. Could I just add as well, this is not just, obviously we represent mostly private sector developers and companies and that, but the regime is such that obviously this is a huge issue for the public sector as they take forward infrastructure projects and so on as well. So I think that really doubles down on the uncertainty as to where we're at the moment.
To refer you to one particular clause which underlines the vagueness, and that's clause 117H. That's the clause that says that the EOR regulations may include provision about or in connection with how and to what extent environmental outcome reports are to be taken into account or given effect by public authorities in considering or making decisions in relation to relevant consents or relevant plans. So that indicates that, you know, it doesn't say how they're going to be taken into account. It says that some future regulations are going to say how they're going to be taken into account. So that this is a cynical in extremis position, but under this bill, if it's passed, the Secretary of State could make provisions that says that the environmental outcome reports don't need to be taken into account when making a decision. Now, I'm not suggesting that that will be the case, but, you know, what is the point of providing a bill that provides regulations that provide almost the possibility of the opposite effect of what you're trying to get? You know, it's so open and every possibility is available that you can't actually determine from what's on the face of the bill what's going to happen.
And just finally, I mean, obviously environmental assessment is a well-established practice and it relates to the Habitats Directive, and there are a set of, you know, tests, I guess, including a public interest test that apply there. Again, we're trying to speculate here as to what may or may not happen, but do you see that kind of practice of appropriate assessment of application of key tests continuing? Or, you know, if we look across to other bills that are being introduced, is there potentially a change in relation to habitats as well, which would seriously, you know, relate to an impact on assessment?
Well, in terms of the Habitats Directive, the first thing I'd say is the Habitats Directive a couple of years ago was subject to a very thorough appraisal called the refit process that was led by the Commission at the instigation of the then UK government, I have to say. So it was a good process, and it concluded the Habitats Directive was fit for purpose and that there were challenges in implementation that needed to be resolved, and that's what in the EU that remains, member states are engaged in. But in relation to this bill, It's clause 127 that deals with interaction with existing environmental assessment legislation and the habitats regulations. And once again, it's just incredibly open and vague. It simply says that any option is on the table, in a sense, in relation to what the regulations may say. They can include provision for amending and disapplying the existing regulations, etc. But what actually is going to happen in those regulations is unknown. So I would A, underline the vagueness, and B, say that the existing tests, particularly Article 6 of the Habitats Directive that deals with significant impact, the tests are, in relation to ensuring protection of protected sites, but equally the tests of where that protection can be overridden in cases of overriding public interest. That is all clear. There's lots of good case law in relation to that. And how and if it will be changed as a result of this is not defined in the bill or in the explanatory notes.
David or Robbie?
I mean, the only thing I think I'd add is from our members' side, it's an industry that now is very driven by institutional investors and other types of investors with demanding requirements on environmental, social governance kind of related criteria. Good regulation, that's clear, that gives them a good framework with which to make their proposals in a better knowledge that they'll be compliant and well received as well, not just by the authorities but by communities as well. Is helpful. It's what they want to do, and it's not just the right thing to do, it's actually in their interest to do it for the reasons I've just spelled out. So I think where we're at now, the authorities are not pushing against a negative industry that is resistant of good regulation, and I think the opportunity would be there to make sure that we do get an agreed way forward with the authorities, whether it's UK, whether it's devolved administrations. But what they would be very worried about was potential schism within those regulations, and if they're not really as well synchronised as they could be between this Parliament and other areas.
Robbie?
We would support, there is elements of the process which we think we can do better, and I think one to sort of focus on is better public engagement. I think EIA, SEAs are as much assessing impact, potential impact, as they are about transparency and kind of accountability as well. Again, back to my sort of comment on sort of digital innovations potentially there as well, but you know, that's an area we'd certainly look for some improvement in a new system. We would also sort of advocate for the retention of consideration of alternatives as part of the existing process. In our submission to the Levelling Up Regeneration Bill, we have asked for a sort of expansion of assessment in terms of population health. Obviously, that would have to be aligned with health impact assessments. That's something that's come through in the Planning Act 2000.
Is this coming through the refit process in the EU as well? Are they responding to the needs for reform around public transparency and wider public health?
I assume they will be to some extent, but I couldn't give you any detail on that.
Lloyd, have you got anything on that point before I hand back to the convener?
No, I've got nothing.
No.
Okay, thanks.
Thanks, Mark. Liam, the next question is yours.
Thank you, convener. Good morning, panel. Lloyd Austin, you began an answer to Monica Lennon by briefly mentioning EU legislation. Now, the Scottish Government took a decision to, as it says, keep pace with EU law. What impact would these provisions have on that decision? And if it turned out that these provisions turned out to enhance and improve on protections, presumably it would be right to go to those protections rather than dogmatically follow an EU position.
That's a hypothetical question, but in that, if that circumstance arose, yes.
Thank you. Robbie Calvert, Lloyd Austin talked about Clause 120 earlier on and suggested I think that it could be amended to be better. In your view, Robbie Calvert, Clause 120 sets out safeguards that ensure that the UK continues to meet its international obligations and includes provisions on non-regression, which are also in the UK-EU Trade and Cooperation Agreement. Does Clause 120 provide sufficient safeguards against a weakening of existing environmental protections?
This is not something we picked up on in our written evidence, but I think from what I can gather, I think I'd be a bit wary of supporting that clause in its current form from what Lloyd said today. I'd be concerned on that clause.
David Malhewish, do you wish to offer anything on
that? I think, as was said earlier, understood that the intention was, well, not to regress, as of course, or to drop below our obligations. I think that's welcome. That's what would be mostly expected. I think what we'd like to see, therefore, is that spelled out in agreement between the devolved administrations and the UK government as well. Which I think would then complement what the UK has agreed with EU and wider. I think that would be our answer on that front.
Thank you. Lloyd Austin, I'll just come back to that first question I asked you, because you answered the second part of it, I think, in answering that it was a hypothetical. But the first part of the question was, what impact would these provisions have on the decision to keep pace with EU law, which I don't think is hypothetical?
Well, first of all, it would depend on the nature of any regulations under these provisions, which is the thing that we don't have. Mm-hmm. Because all this bill does is provide the power for the Secretary of State to make regulations, and those regulations haven't been seen, or even a detailed policy proposal. Robbie mentioned the consultation is still to come. So, the question that you've put, although you've not phrased it in a hypothetical way, it is hypothetical in a sense because of that absence of the sight of the regulations or the policy for those regulations. But hypothetically, if they made any impact on the Scottish law in a devolved area that implemented past EU law, retained EU law, whatever you call it, and made a change that regressed in some way, then that would be contrary to the Scottish Government's policy position of keeping pace. But the keeping pace provision in the Continuity Act is a discretionary one for them to choose to use when they wish or otherwise, because of course they can keep pace by other provisions as well in existing environmental law, not just through Continuity Act. And so you would have a potential position where the UK government was legislating in a devolved area in contradiction to what the Scottish Government desired. And so you would end up with a situation that was a sort of clause 121 situation where currently it's about consultation. And if agreement was reached, then that would be fine. But if there was contradiction, you could have two governments submitting to their two separate parliaments contradictory legislation. And which one, I think the preference from our point of view would be for a provision that if matters are devolved, then it should have the consent of this parliament. Mm-hmm. And therefore agreement should be reached to achieve that consent.
No further questions, Convener.
Thank you, Liam, for that. Just caught me a little bit. I think there's a deputy convener coming in now. Natalie, yes. Sorry, I apologise, Natalie.
That's
I missed
okay.
you.
Thank you.
An oversight.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, everyone. I think we've touched on this a little bit, but I'd like some further explanation on it. How might the proposed system of EORs affect public and stakeholder participation in decision-making on new developments? And I'll turn first to Lloyd, please.
I think the answer to the question is it all depends again on what are the regulations, what's the content of those regulations that flow from the provisions of this bill. I'm seeking to recall whether there are any things that say that the regulations have to include provision for public engagement and consultation and so on. And I think they do at some point, but I think the answer has to be it depends what's in those regulations that follow.
So we come back to uncertainty.
We come back to uncertainty and lack of clarity.
Okay. I don't know if you both will have the same answer for that, but I'm happy to bring you in. I was going to come to Robbie next.
We don't have the clarity at the moment, but it's certainly an area where we could improve. Do we need a new set of regulations to improve in that area? Well, I'm not sure about that so much. As I said, with some of the digital engagement, for example, and tools there we could use to enhance community engagement, but it's certainly something that we've set out in our response to the Levelling Up Regeneration Bill that we want to see that part of the system enhanced.
Okay. David, do you have anything to add?
Compliment really what was suggested earlier, and as Robbie's just said, obviously there's there are work streams to improve digitalisation of the wider regime. I would suggest that some of the experiences our members had over the period we've had over the last 2 years is with the fact that there was much more online public engagement involved with. The increase in participation was really noticeable, and so I think it's those kind of lines and areas that can be improved, respecting the fact that not everyone will be conversant with online engagement and so on. So in-person events are still very much a part of the system. I'd really support what was said by Lloyd and Robbie.
Thank you all. Thanks. No further questions.
Thanks, Natalie. And now it's the Deputy Convener, Fiona.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning. I'm interested in policy coherence. Clearly, environment and planning legislation is devolved. I want to come to Robert Calvert first, and I'm interested in how might part five of the bill impact upon the fourth national planning framework specifically. So I'll come to Robbie and then I'll come to David.
Yes, so as I mentioned, we want to see these proposals mapped out into existing proposals, including planning reform. I think I mentioned earlier about different policy approaches in terms of biodiversity net gain, and the policy that's sitting within the draft MPF4 at the moment. We have a wider concern that the draft MPF4 as it is at the moment will be an additional amount of duties for decision makers within that. And as a part of that, there'll be a resource implication, but also a sort of kind of skills issue there as well, in terms of planners having to deal with a huge amount of additional issues, essentially. So we're quite concerned that any reform in this area could cause a significant issue to a planning system that's already in flux. We're struggling in terms of resource, both financial but also personnel as well at the moment. We are working with Scottish Government to push forward an apprenticeship scheme to deal with that. There's a huge issue there around skills. And is this a good time for the planning system to implement a whole new reform in environmental impact assessment and strategic environmental assessment? Big question mark over that, I think, from our side of things.
So it's, and David, the interaction between the bill we're looking at, the LCM on the bill we're looking at, and the MPF4 draft, what's your view?
Just to add to Robinson, obviously MPF4 now will incorporate Scottish planning policy, which details out the development management system. Mm-hmm. So obviously if we're looking at a motion now, which you'd hope wouldn't conflict in detail with the principles and requirements of EIAs as we know them and assessments, we don't know because we don't see the detail yet. So Yeah, I think that's a concern, in particular the timing. I mean, you know, we're expecting to see MPF4 come back imminently. And, you know, we had wider concerns, I think other stakeholders had with, you know, looking at some of the delivery and some of the detail behind the original propositions, MPF4. So I think the timing is a particular concern right now, as well as the, you know, the underlying principles behind potential conflict.
Okay, thank you. And I can turn to Lloyd Austin now. In terms of the lack of detail, we know that bills at, from both governments at a particular point, you will have lack of detail until you necessarily have regulations granted. But we've heard, obviously, concerns from particularly English NGOs environmentally about what might happen. We've got a new government, obviously, at the UK level. And in fact, one of the first things that they've announced as of Monday is exempting business with fewer than 500 employees from reporting requirements of other regulations. And they've also said in the statement that the change in the threshold would apply to all new regulations under development, as well as those under current and future review, including retained EU laws. Now, perhaps one of the early clarifications we might get is if the UK government is saying there's going to be non-regression in terms of environmental law, if they could clarify that the non-regression would apply to this, that would give very early indication that actually non-regression will stand. Is that something that you share?
Yes, I think one thing I was I got into in answer to Monica Lennon's question, which was premature, I apologise for that, but the context in which these provisions are being considered includes the retained EU law bill, as well as the sort of new proposals that have come out in the last week or so. And many of those suggest weakening of environmental law of one type or another. Indeed, the NGOs in England have started a campaign about the attack on nature, as it's put. And that is a very serious concern because, you know, if you were to exempt any business with under 500 employees from all environmental regulations, which would be a potential interpretation of that phrase, that would mean, well, most businesses. It would certainly mean most farmers and landowners, most businesses. And that does give you some degree of concern as to what's the point of environmental legislation if you then exempt 99% of the people having an impact on the environment one way or another, or potential impact on the environment. So there is serious concern. And as I say, the one clause in Part 5 of this bill that calls itself a non-regression clause is in my view, weak. And there are ways in which that could be improved. But, you know, in some ways, those other provisions, whether it be the retained EU law bill or the other policy ideas that are floating around in the last week or so, are in other bits of legislation. But they do appear to be inconsistent even with the intent of the non-regression clause in this bill.
Clarification by the UK government of what they've announced on Monday, yeah, would at least give us some certainty as to what may or may not happen.
Yeah.
Okay. If I can then move on to trying to understand this from a very practical point of view, what will it mean for projects in particular? And maybe turning to Robbie next. In relation to outcomes and the EORs, the environmental outcome reports, you can see a sense in that from a policy point of view. There are some concerns about it. You can see the sense of it. But if you were to take large developments, either onshore or even potentially offshore, that from an environmental assessment need some kind of mitigation, but the mitigation might not be able to happen on a very granular small scale, but may have to happen elsewhere. Who would decide that? Would that be a Scottish minister would decide where the mitigation would take place, or would that, under this legislation, be the Secretary of State that would decide where the mitigation from the environmental outcome would be? Because that's a very practical, real thing that could happen.
I'm not entirely sure. I think that one may be better placed for Lloyd at this stage. And I'm not sure we've quite got the detail at
okay,
the moment.
That's fine.
My understanding of your question is who is responsible for taking a decision about mitigation?
Yeah.
I think the answer is whoever's responsible for the consenting of the project. So if it's a devolved matter, it's Scottish ministers, and if it's a reserved matter, it would be the relevant Secretary of State.
So clearly, in some areas, and perhaps it may be more for offshore, where planning is actually devolved and it's mixed because energy is reserved, that may be an issue that we might want to pursue to say who would decide where the mitigations would be, because the consenting
indeed,
should be
and
devolved.
And offshore mitigation and compensation plans need to be agreed strategically, because as well as mitigation and compensation, they don't necessarily... The responsibility for the mitigation and compensation could fall with the other jurisdiction, but equally that mitigation or compensation might be delivered in a different geographic jurisdiction. So you could imagine, for instance, a offshore wind farm off Northumberland that the developer agrees through the EIA process that there's a requirement for compensation, and they effectively come to an agreement with the Crown Estate and landowners to deliver that compensation in the further forth, which would be in the Scottish jurisdiction. So because, you know, birds and whales and dolphins and wildlife move across borders all the time, so there needs to be join up between the two administrations, and that's one of the reasons why I would always fall back on the fact that there should be agreement rather than...
Yeah. So that comes back to consent rather than consultation. Yeah. And then just finally, David, you talked about the importance of enabling infrastructure investments and developments, and I suppose that's what I'm also interested in, is how, if the environmental outcome report is the jurisdictions of the Secretary of State only in consultation, with the devolved administration, how you know, is that, will that enable or hinder developments? Because we actually want to make things happen, but it's actually it's the speed at which decision making can take, and the issue is whether that's better done more locally. But land based probably would be more devolved, quite clearly more devolved, unless it's a big energy project, for example, a nuclear, whatever.
Yeah, and again, really, this is why we need to know. There is the potential for a lot of delay in the system and the process by which the decision makers are actually allowed to come to their decision as well, which we just don't have at the moment in any detail. It's not to argue that the current regime is flawless, faultless. There are several different competent authorities for different aspects of the environmental assessment system. And there are situations where decisions are prolonged over periods of time to the extent that even relatively smallish major developments can take years and years and years and do not materialise just because of a lack of decision making between competent authorities. And, there are instances I can think of that mean that you've hundreds of houses. If an example comes to mind, affordable houses do not actually get delivered just because of that standoff between various competent authorities. We're not arguing the current system is flawless, but at least we know what it is.
You know what it is. Mm. Thank you very much, Camilla.
Thank you. I've got a couple of questions I might just pose at the end. EU regulation is interesting, environmental regulation, because it ends up and by nature of it, pickling things in aspic and not allowing things to change. We tend to feed into it, and they tend to follow a precautionary principle that no damage can be done. And whilst that may be right, there may be benefits from what's happening. Do you think the... and I've heard, Lloyd, your comments on it. I'd be interested in David and Robbie's comment on it. As far as the EU precautionary principle on environment, do you think that is... gives enough flexibility? David, do you want to go with that? Or you're writing. If you're ready, Robbie, I'm happy to go with you. Robbie, it's you.
We'd support the precautionary principle. I think even going back slightly there to Fiona's point as well, there's no clear evidence that the EIAs are necessarily the part of a process in development which does delay developments. And I reference back to my written evidence there. So there's a report from IEMA on the matter, Levelling Up EIA to Build Back Better, it's called. And they set up a number of reasons why there is delays in projects. And as far as we haven't seen the evidence at the moment, the evidence change, we haven't seen conclusive evidence that the EIAs are necessarily what's holding up large infrastructure projects, and there's a number of other things. And a lot of that touches upon things that I spoke about earlier regarding resourcing, for example, of not only planning departments, but statutory consultees as well.
Mm. I think, Robbie, I'm not saying they're holding things up. I'm just wondering if they're preventing development, which may have benefits across the whole environment, rather than just the original area that may have been designated or fall within a designation for a species of flora or fauna.
Well, I think it depends project to project. And, you know, that I don't think these decisions are easy to make. I think, you know, there's some tricky, you know, it's not black and white. And that's why we have these processes in place. And yes, there's a desire to simplify them, but you can only simplify them to a certain degree because they are inherently complex decision-making processes that we're dealing with.
Okay, David, do you want to come back on that?
I suppose the answer that we have is sometimes, which is not very helpful, but an example does strike me that, you know, concerns you know, based on precautionary principle around certain species have delayed developments and then found actually several months down the line to have not in actual fact have been material to the development process. So sometimes they can. There can be a tendency towards caution, understandable in many ways if you see that there be you know, something legal first down the line or by a decision-making authority, a competent authority. So I think I can possibly only answer that sometimes it does.
Lloyd, very briefly, you want to come in? Very briefly.
Yeah, just on context in terms of the precautionary principle, it's one of four so-called EU environmental principles that were embedded in the Treaty of Lisbon before we left. All four principles are now incorporated in domestic law. They're incorporated in Scotland through the Continuity Act, but the UK government has carried them over into domestic law for England and for reserve matters as well in the Environment Act 2021. So they are and that Environment Act also applies to devolved matters in Northern Ireland, so the gap is Wales that needs devolved legislation on EU principles. Whether the precautionary principle is overzealously applied or not is a matter of, I think, judgment and so on. But I think, as Robbie says, it's case to case. The principle itself, in principle, is a good principle. And it's good that all the respective governments have put it into domestic law in the absence of it being in EU law now that we've left. The issues that you raise as being a potential problem are about the implementation and interpretation of it. And that is, both governments have consulted on guidance in terms of the interpretation and the application of it. Neither government has yet finalised and published that guidance, but that would be the place to address your concerns, I would think.
Not necessarily concerns. I may be delighted that the precautionary principle is there because it overrides a lot of decisions in relating to environmental law, and therefore I would argue that it's actually a good thing and maybe strengthens this whole act by the fact that it is in UK and Scottish legislation. So just turning to the three areas I seem to have picked up on, is you feel that the word consult in clause 21.21 isn't sufficiently strong enough, and you are concerned that there are regulations which you haven't seen which could be worse but aren't definitely worse, and you're worried that the regression clause is not strong enough at clause 120. If there was a bit more detail on those, would it resolve all your concerns? You could give a yes or no answer, but I suspect you won't. Lloyd, you want to start off on that?
Whether we answer yes or no to that would depend on whether or not the proposals that sought to address the concerns did address the concerns. We'd have to. It would be kind of it's a kind of a hypothetical question again. It is possible that all of the regulations, when they are published, and the guidance that goes with them, etc. It's a perfectly benign type of proposal, but we haven't seen it. That's what's so, in a sense, difficult to make a judgment about. That's why we don't necessarily think it's bad or badly has a bad intent, but it's just too vague to be clear about.
Robbie, do you briefly want to say on that?
Yeah, I think you capture some of our issues at the moment, and agreeing with Lloyd, we'd need to see further detail to see if any other potential issues arise from those.
David?
I think I'd just add how it relates to the existence policy-making regime and regulatory regime. I think that's critically important for those embarking on complex major developments.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you. Unless there's any other questions for anyone, thank you very much for taking time, and I think at quite short notice as well, for some of you anyway. So I appreciate you finding the time and coming to the committee this morning. I'm briefly going to suspend the meeting to set up for our next agenda item, so the meeting is suspended. Thank you, everyone, and welcome back. Our third item of business today is to take evidence on a consent notification on the Biocidal Products Health and Safety Amendment Regulations 2022. This is a forthcoming UK statutory instrument on which the Scottish Government consent to legislate is sought. The Scottish Parliament has a role subject to a protocol and scrutiny of the Scottish Government consent to UK secondary legislation in devolved areas arising from the EU exit. There is a short report deadline on this notification. As such, we'll be hearing from the Scottish Government on its proposals to consent. Today, we're going to hear from Murray McCallum, the Minister for Environment and Land Reform, Dan Merkel, Chemicals Team Leader, and Luigi, I'm not going to get that right, I apologise. Right, there we go, thank you. I got it right then, solicitor for the Scottish Government. We've got about 25 minutes for this, and I'm going to ask the Minister to make an opening statement. And I believe there's a slight alteration or correction you want to make regarding the notification, Minister. So over to you.
Thanks very much, Convener. Thank you for having us and for the opportunity to just give some opening remarks, which I'll do on the substance of the SI, which I hope will be helpful because it's complicated, and then I'll address the error afterwards. So this SI relates to the process by which biocidal products, which are namely those used to control or protect people, animals, materials or articles from pests or bacteria, it controls the way these are considered for access to the GB market. The overall purpose of the SI is to put in place temporary measures to allow the Health and Safety Executive sufficient time to process a very large number of applications that were received under transitional arrangements following EU exit. So the GB regime, as I'll refer to it, ensures that any products placed on the GB market are safe to use and efficacious. Suppliers or manufacturers of biocidal products have to apply for authorisation from the HSE to be able to sell or use their products, and that within specific timeframes. Now, transitional arrangements under the GB regime have seen the Health and Safety Executive receive a very large influx of applications. They cannot deal with these within the legal deadlines of the GB regime as it stands, and so this SI purports to extend them for certain applications. Now, the authorisation procedure in the GB regime depends on the type of application being made. And the changes made by this SI will affect the legal deadlines across various different applications. So the the Health and Safety Executive is confident that amending the regulation as proposed will allow it to process the applications that it's received, and that within the extended deadlines, applications will be processed on a rolling basis. Work has already started on this, and it's expected that the majority will have been processed before 31 December 2027, i.e. the new deadline. Now, Scottish ministers consider this situation should have been foreseeable. The events that have made it necessary were not of our choosing. But dealing with the situation in hand, we do think that the risk to businesses, to consumers and to the environment of not agreeing the extension and thereby hindering the operability of the new GB regime would pose a greater risk to the environment and to public health and the economy than allowing this temporary extension. And of course, if consent is not granted, the practical implication will be that as current evaluation deadlines pass, large numbers of biocidal products legally would need to be phased off the GB market. Now, thank you for the time to set that out. I'll just very briefly address the error. This was in the notification and the notification summary that we submitted to the committee on 23 September. The error is that the notification does not accurately describe just one of the proposed legislative changes, but this is a minor change compared with the effect of the SI overall. I'll explain it for the record. It's very complicated, so bear with me. The original notification, it stated that the SI introduced a new transitional provision into the GB regime, and it said that this would allow applications to modify an authorisation made under the EU regime before the implementation day, and that that would be transferred to the GB regime, provided that the application and relevant information had been resubmitted. That's what we put to the committee. Instead, it should have stated that the new transitional provision will allow applications made to HSE before implementation day completion day, and that under specifically under Implementation Regulation 414/2013, which are subject to the simplified authorisation procedure, and for biocidal products that are identical to another that is already authorised or under assessment, that these should be resubmitted and considered for authorisation under the GB regime. My officials have informed me that this was the result of oversights and drafting, and that we let the committee know as soon as we could. But I can only express my apologies, convener, for this oversight in what is clearly a very technically complicated piece of work. Thank you,
Minister, and thank you for the explanation, and thank you also for notifying the committee by letter, so we had a chance to consider it prior to the meeting today. So I think the first questions this morning are going to come from Jackie. Is that you?
Thank you. Good morning. What are the current deadlines set out in the GB Biodiesel Products Regulation? Sorry, it's a bit of a mouthful. And how will these proposals change that?
Yeah, thank you. We know this is technical. I'll try and address each of the questions in turn, but I do have both my legal and my policy colleague with me to help me on that. I like to think of the timelines in this regime as being in two tiers. First of all, the timelines by which applications had to be resubmitted in the transitional period. This is 90 days for applications where the UK was originally the evaluating member state, and 180 days where an EU member state was originally the evaluator. That then, once resubmitted, that triggers with the Health and Safety Executive the need to validate these without delay, and that's the term that's used in the legislation. The applicant then has to pay a fee, which I understand is 30 days. And once that has been done, this triggers the period in which the HSE have to consider the application. Now, previously, that would, for the most part, or for certain applications that are touched by this SI, that would have been 365 days. What we're now proposing is that the deadline be 31 December 2027. And that's in order to give the Health and Safety Executive the time to evaluate the influx of applications that they've had since EU exit. So that's the principal change. I can ask any of my colleagues if there's anything that they want to add to that.
Thank
for you. And you're on.
Okay, thank you. All I was going to say was I was going to turn to my my legal colleague Luigi to answer the question on timescales a bit further.
So, as the Minister's outlined, the GB regime sets out various deadlines by which an application has to be authorised. And the trigger point for the start of those timelines is the date on which the HSE, the Health and Safety Executive, notifies the applicant of the relevant fees. The relevant fees will depend on the type of application in question. Once notified, the applicant, as the Minister said, has 30 days in which they must pay the fees. And once they've paid the fees, after 30 days, the Health and Safety Executive either needs to accept or validate the application. The distinction between acceptance and validation depends on the type of application. And thereafter, the evaluation period starts to run. And that will be 365 days if it's for a kind of standard authorisation, national authorisation, but it might be shorter if it's a different type of application. What the proposed law does is it postpones the date on which the HSE, the Health and Safety Executive, needs to notify applicants of that date, i.e. pushes it back to the 31st of December 2027. Mm. So it then means that if a applicant is notified of the fees at that later date, the application evaluation period will start to run from that date onwards. Where a applicant is notified of the fees sufficiently in advance of that date, the 31st December 2027, so that the HSE can complete its evaluation before the 31st December 2027, then it has to complete its evaluation by that date.
Okay, thank you. Can I ask the Minister what discussions that you've had or the Scottish Government have had with the UK Government about the impact of the loss of access to EU data on HSE's timescales for evaluating applications for authorisations?
Yeah, absolutely. So I mentioned in my opening remarks that this... We're trying to work through what I think would be fair to call, you know, a situation that we didn't want to find ourselves in and that isn't of our making. And since throughout the whole preparations for EU exit, the Scottish Government was absolutely clear that negotiated access to the EU's chemical database was important and should be pursued. That hasn't transpired. Regrettably, UK Government pursued the hardest of Brexits, and we don't have access to the EU database anymore. But your question is about, you know, to what extent has the Scottish Government made representations to the UK Government? We have been doing that since right throughout the preparations for Brexit.
Okay. Thank you.
Natalie.
Much, Convener, and good morning, Minister. Yeah, my question kind of follows on directly from that. So in terms of the loss of access to that data, will that result in delays in evaluating applications for authorisations in the long term, so beyond this?
Yeah. I'm sort of hesitating because I think it's actually very difficult to predict with certainty what all of the implications of this are across biocidal products, across the chemicals regime of EU exit and our attempts to try and manage GB-wide processes as best we possibly can. Because, of course, we've moved from a situation where it was, you know, authorisation was done on a EU-wide basis, where in some circumstances you'd have mutual recognition between member states. So if it was authorised in one country, you know, you would have mutual recognition elsewhere, and that clearly reduced the workload for the authorisers. But to give some confidence to the committee, for I think for normal applications, we would expect most of the information that's required to be on the face of the application, and therefore, you know, in those circumstances, not having access to that EU database shouldn't hinder the authorisation process. But there is no doubt that this is complicated, and it's very difficult to foresee sometimes what the problems will be before they arise.
Thanks very much. Thank you.
Minister, just before we go, move on from that, I mean, a lot of chemical applications will be for on-label use, but a different permutation of the chemical application. So they will have data sheets anyway, and if they've applied for a use in the European Union, surely they'll be submitting that information voluntarily and the questions asked by the European Union in regarding to that chemical use in the UK to the HSE. So it shouldn't slow it up that much, surely.
I think on your latter point, if I understand you correct, the information that would be required to authorise in the EU and in GB are very similar, and they will be similar. And yes, I think, you know, as I said, we would expect for normal applications for the information that would be required to be on the face of the application. And therefore, for normal applications, I wouldn't expect delays to run beyond this transitional period, which is just delayed owing to a big influx of applications rather necessarily than a lack of information on each of the applications.
So, sorry, just so I understand this, they'll run in tandem both for the EU and the UK for an application, and so a lot of the information will be asked will be similar by EU and UK. So I can't see how, if the company's developing that, that's going to slow things down.
I'll bring my colleagues in. I don't think there's any guarantee they run in tandem. We have asked HSE, I think, to consider the way that they prioritise the applications that they get, but I don't think that running in tandem is something we could...
And Dan, I'll bring you in on that. I mean, it's unlikely that most chemical manufacturers will see the UK as a big enough market to develop something. Will they not be doing it in tandem?
I don't think things will run in tandem. I think the thing to bear in mind is there are many different kinds of applications here. It's not just one type of application, unfortunately. So where there's prior knowledge, say, in the EU system that we may not have access to in GB system, that could result in delays, I think. But where we have normal applications that are the subject of this SI, it shouldn't result in any delay. As the Minister says, the information available in the data package as submitted should be sufficient to allow the HSE to conduct their evaluation. As we've said all along, I think the Minister has said, it's a very complicated situation with lots of different kinds of applications, different provisions to make sure that everything is assessed in time in the GB regime. And that's against the sort of backdrop of this sort of staggered approach in the EU anyway, where evaluations are entirely driven by when an application is made to a competent authority in a particular member state of the EU, which can happen at any time. And maybe it's worth mentioning as well that delays in EU member states' evaluations were quite common and are still quite common in the EU system. So there's all these sort of competing elements going on that mean it's very difficult to sort of compare the two regimes in terms of timescales.
Okay, thank you. Deputy Convener, I think that's to you now.
That's interesting. It sounds as if, from what I've heard, it would be possible to piggyback on EU applications, but you'd be reliant on the information that the applicant themselves has provided to the EU as opposed to the database of the approvals or consideration. Is that correct?
Yes, I think so. If the applicant was interested in trading in the GB market as well as the EU market, there's nothing to stop them submitting an application to both regimes. So
on the same, yeah. But you're reliant on the applicant as opposed to the approvals. On the issue about volume of work, can I just ask what discussions that the Scottish Government has had with the UK Government about how it's ensuring that the HSE is sufficiently resourced to effectively carry out these functions and to reduce delays in processing authorisations under this GB biocidal product regulatory regime?
Yes, of course. I think, as would be expected, there was a lot of work done in preparation for EU exit and in anticipation of what HSE, on behalf of devolved ministers and Secretary of State of UK Government, would be undertaking, because the HSE is our agent in these matters. So the kind of work that was undertaken, there was a scaling up of, I can't actually remember the name of the division within HSE that, chemicals regulation division. There was a scaling up of that particular group in order to make sure that they had the resources. This was matched by financial resourcing being scaled up as well, all in preparation for the work that was coming. Just to give some context to that five-year period, that hasn't just been, it's not just been surmised by HSE that that's the amount of time that they'll need. That has been based on modelling of how quickly they're getting through applications as is. So there has been a scaling up. It's been ongoing as part of EU exit preparations. And the time that's now being asked for is based on modelling of what they think is possible.
And how does that compare to progress and pace with the EU in terms of their approvals or indeed non-approvals? So how will the delays that we're hearing about impact the Scottish Government's ability to keep pace with the EU in this area?
I think there is undoubtedly scope for a lack of alignment now between the GB regime and the EU regime, where something could be approved in the EU and not in GB, and vice versa. And I know Dan mentioned that the EU regime can be subject to delays and things as well. So there's undoubtedly scope for a lack of alignment. Whether the practical implications of that are very different depending on the type of product, whether it was on the market already prior to EU exit, whether it's a new product. So it's all different, but there is scope for misalignment.
Okay, thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Mark Ruskell.
With the delayed evaluations that will be done, is there a danger that we'll be running behind the science? And what assessment has there been around what the potential risks might be to environment and human health of that?
Yeah, I think it's a good question. And again, there's lots of different permutations, different products, different times they've been on the market, different conditions of use. So it's difficult to answer all in one go. I suppose something that I take a lot of comfort in is that the EU have informed HSE that the active substance within the product, which makes it biocidal, will have been party to an EU-wide consideration, and we've been given comfort on the effect of it, the active substance itself. And you know, there's different treatments of different products. So, for example, what we're saying here is that if you have a product that was already on the market prior to transition, it's going to be able to stay on the market for a bit longer to allow this influx of applications to be processed, but the conditions of use will still be in place. And if you have a new product, you're not going to be able to be on the market until after that extended period. So, you know, I, again, take comfort in that. But having said that, I might hand over to Dan just to see if he's got anything else to add. And I think it all comes back to a point which I tried to make in my opening remarks, which is that, you know, we need a process of oversight and authorisation to work and to work properly, and the risks to the environment and to human health and indeed to the economy are greater in not allowing that extension and having the authorisations take place, albeit that we wouldn't want to be here. Mm-hmm. Dan, I've kind of probably said all there is to say, but just anything else?
Yeah, I'll probably just try and emphasise something the Minister mentioned, which is the BPR in GB and the EU is a two-tier system, so all of the active substances that actually have the biocidal action in a product, they all have to be approved and they have to go through a rigorous safety and efficacy assessment to be put on a placed on a list that means that all approved active substances have to be on this list. And when that evaluation takes place, the applicant has to also submit one example of a product type that the active substance is used in to check for kind of safety in that product. So the HSE have confirmed that all of the active substances in this very large number of products that they need to evaluate have been through that process. So it does give us that baseline of safety. And maybe the other thing to mention is that if we were to have intelligence that a product in the EU had not been authorised following evaluation by a member state, we would hope that the HSE would prioritise that particular product if it's in the GB system here for evaluation.
Yeah, we would hope that's the case, wouldn't we? Can I just ask about the potential for increased animal testing? Because that's something that's been raised in relation to REACH.
Sorry, I didn't quite hear that question.
Can I raise the issue of potential for increased animal testing? Because that's been raised in relation to REACH and the implementation of that.
Kavina, can I just ask Mr. Ruskell just to elaborate a little further on the question, please?
It was a point that actually raised Michael Gove, who actually took it quite seriously. But obviously, if there's a process of going through evaluation, could an impact of that be increased animal testing if particular products have to effectively go through a re-evaluation process any point, or any active ingredients within those products?
I see what you mean now, and I can see why that would be a pertinent question in the context of chemicals regulation generally. I think when it comes to this SI, because of the specific timescales, etc., and the tweaks that this is seeking to make, and because of the fact that no new product will enter the market within the time frame, and any existing product which has had its time on the market extended will do so under the current conditions of use, I think I would be comfortable that there wasn't a risk there. But Dan, is there anything you would like to add to that? I mean, Mark, perhaps we can come back to you with some more information.
Minister, I think Dan actually gave the answer that all the chemicals that were sitting within this packet of chemicals looking for authorisation already had an on-label use, already being used, so therefore they wouldn't need to be tested and revalued again. Is that not what you said?
Yes, so the applications are there already, basically. So unless the applicant has put in a data waiver, so they've sort of tried to demonstrate they don't need to conduct a particular test, that the testing is already has already been conducted for the particular cases that, that this SI addresses. But I understand that MSP's point, and it is a wider concern across the GB chemicals regimes.
Okay, thanks.
Liam, I think you wanted to come in with a question at that stage.
Yes, thank you, Convener. Good morning, panel. Given the potential for risk and significant delays in evaluating authorisations, why is the Scottish Government not engaged or consulted with stakeholders to assess the impact of these proposals?
Thanks for the question. I certainly agree with the first part of it, that there is potential for risks known and unknown. But on the second part, we, since 2017, have had ongoing engagement with stakeholders, industry, trade, environmental NGOs, and that through the Scottish Chemical Policy Network. And that is a network exactly for ongoing consultation and engagement with stakeholders, who we encourage at all stages of this complex journey to come forward and to raise issues with us.
Forgive me, Minister, might I just press you on that, because the Type 1 notification that you submitted to the committee says these new measures are aimed solely at ensuring the functioning of the GBPR, BPR, and therefore we have not undertaken any engagement or any formal consultation about these specific amendments, which is I think is rather at odds with the answer you just gave. Would you like to just clarify that?
No, of course. Happy to clarify. The network has been set up in 2017, since 2017, as a forum for by which stakeholders could approach Scottish Government with concerns across, you know, as I said, industry, trade, ENGOs. So it's not true to say that we don't consult on it. And the forum is there should stakeholders wish to raise matters with us, and we actively encourage them to do so.
Forgive me, Minister, but the Type 1 notification says that there hasn't been that formal consultation. And I think what you're saying to me is there is an opportunity there, but the actual engagement consultation hasn't, as a fact, been carried out as the committee's been notified in the Type 1 notification. Is that correct?
Yes, no, that is correct. The opportunity is there. It's been there since 2017. It's a live forum, and it's the way that, in a sort of reciprocal basis, we engage with stakeholders across the piece. Now, you know, what you're quoting there is right, and, you know, I can maybe hand over to Dan to say a little bit more about the decisions that were made about what to consult on specifically and when. But that forum is there, and it operates well as a go-between between government and stakeholders. Dan, do you want to add anything to that?
Okay, thanks, Minister. I'd probably emphasise that it's a GB regime, so the market is obviously across the whole of GB for biocidal products. So any consultation would probably be arguably be better done at a GB level. As the Minister says, we've got this forum in place which allows stakeholders in Scotland to approach us with any issues that they may have. And it's probably worth also mentioning that we were made aware of this issue, I think, in May this year. So it's not something we would have actively had the chance to consult on, because we were only made aware of it quite late on.
Thank you. No further questions.
Thanks, Liam. Monica, the next question is yours.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Minister and your officials. Just hopefully an easy question. We've had your written submission, but I just wonder if you can advise the committee if you're aware of any change to the proposed laying date at Westminster, which we believe is the 17th of October. Is that still the case?
Yes, that's the case as far as I'm concerned. I'm not aware of any changes. 17th of October is the date in mind. However, I know that officials have been engaging with HSE on this, but I assume you don't have anything else to say on that, Dan. It's 17th of October as far as we're concerned.
Good, so you're confident of that. There's been discussion. Given the short timescales involved here, which has meant that this committee has only had a short time to consider the notification, I think roughly 10 or 11 days instead of the 28 days normally available for scrutiny. Just for the record, can we hear, Minister, from you why the notification was not sent to the committee until Friday 23rd September?
Yeah, absolutely. And I should like to open just by apologising to the committee for the short timescales that have transpired here. It's been a combination of factors of us, I think, you know, Dan mentioned it's a GB-wide piece of work. We have received drafts which have then changed, and that's not anyone's fault. That's just the nature of what we're doing here. It's a very complicated set of provisions which require a lot of close consideration by officials and by legal colleagues. And then, of course, we did have the mourning period for Queen Elizabeth's passing, which did affect the point at which we could officially come to the committee. But I can only apologise for it and just say that we're glad to be able to be here today to give you evidence.
Thank you for that, Minister, and also for acknowledging, you know, how complex this item is. So it is important that the committee gets, you know, as much time as possible. Just on that, because you've mentioned a combination of factors, including the death of Queen Elizabeth and the national period of mourning, is that something in terms of contingency plans, how we can avoid delays in future if there are other royal events or national events? Because clearly there's a lot of pressure on officials as well. So is there anything that could be done differently in future to try and protect time? Because the scrutiny timetable is important, I'm sure you will agree.
Yeah, no, I absolutely do agree. And I think for our part, we commit to continual improvement when it comes to time to assess the drafts that we receive, times to give Scottish ministers views on them, and to get them to the committee. I think when it comes to something quite an extraordinary event like the passing of the Queen, we all had practical issues that we had to think about and deal with, and it was a quite unusual situation. Now, of course, we'll have learned from that. We hope not to have to do that very often, but certainly we will have learned that and about interaction with committee during periods like that. But certainly on the parts that were entirely in our gift, we commit to continually trying to improve.
Thank you, Minister. Thank you,
and Monica, I should actually, I know the Minister doesn't need defending, but she came at fairly short notice today because this wasn't planned till the latter part of last week. So there has been some flexibility from the Government to the Committee, which I would thank you for, Minister. Does anyone have any further questions? Okay, on that basis, thank you very much, Minister, and your officials for taking part. And we're going to move on to Agenda Item 4, which is the consideration of the Consent Notification for the Biocidal Products Health and Safety Amendment Regulations 2022, which is yet to be laid. The Scottish Government proposes to consent to this instrument, as we addressed in the previous agenda item. There are several options, of course, open to the committee, all of which result in a letter to the Scottish Government stating our view. The first, that if members are content, we can approve the proposal to consent. The committee will then write to the Scottish Government indicating that. The second is members can approve the proposal to consent and in the letter confirming this, seek any further information if members have any further inquiries. And if the members are not content with the proposal, the recommendations we can make to the Scottish Government are in paragraph 9 of our paper 3. And these include the Scottish Government should not give consent to propose. The Scottish Government should produce an alternative Scottish legislative solution, that the Scottish Government requests the provisions be made in a UK SA laid in both parliaments under the joint procedure, or that the provision should not be made at all. Those are our options. I hope I've made it clear. Do any members have any comments on what the evidence they've heard this morning? On the basis I'm not seeing anyone leaping in to make any comments, my question is to move to the substantive question on this item, which is the committee content that the provision set out in the notification should be made in the proposed UK statutory instrument? Do we agree? We are agreed. Gosh, that was simple and saved it going to a vote. So we will write to the Scottish Government to that effect by its deadline of the 11th of October. My question to the committee, therefore, is the committee content to delegate the authority for me to sign off the letter to the Scottish Government informing it of our decision today? Natalie, I hope that you're not going to say no. Thank you very much. We have agreed. The fifth item on the agenda... and Minister, yes, please do slip away because I know you're busy, is on the agenda this morning is consideration of another consent notification for a UK statutory instrument. The instrument is the Persistent Organic Pollutants Amendment EU Regulations 2022, which has not yet been laid. The Scottish Government proposes to consent to this instrument, which, as the clerk's papers indicate, relates to the new UK chemicals regulatory regime for persistent organic pollutants. As discussed in the previous item, a protocol has been agreed between the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament for situations where the Government is proposing to consent to certain types of secondary legislation made by the UK Government as a result of the EU exit. The protocol sets out how the Scottish Parliament may scrutinise these decisions. There is a statutory requirement that the Scottish Government's consent must be sought for this proposal, and I refer members to a paper for agenda item 5. Again, there are multiple options open for this committee. The first is... I'm not going to go through all of these proposals again, but they're exactly the same as in the previous codes. I just wondered if there were any comments that members wanted to make in relation to this. If there are no comments, can I just move to the substantive question, and is the committee content that the provision set out in the notification should be made in the proposed UK statutory instrument? We are agreed. Therefore, we will write to the Scottish Government to that effect, and I assume that everyone is happy to delegate authority for me to sign off that letter. That's agreed. Now, that concludes the public part of our meeting, and we are now going to move it into private session. Thank you.